This is the Voice of Freedom. To the Worldwide Freedom Radio Network. If you would like to help yourself and help the Worldwide Freedom Radio Network continue to expand its programming and remain viable and on the satellite for all of our affiliate stations and loyal listeners, call 1-800-295-2432. That's 1-800-295-2432. And ask how you can obtain the Economic Survival Pack number 1. Do it now, folks. You know how you are.
This is my daddy's station. I'm Pooh, classic radio like you always wished it could be. 101.1 FM, Eager.
101.1 FM is owned and operated by the Independent Foundation Trust as a non-profit community service.
You're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Ladies and gentlemen, today we're going to fulfill the promise that I made to you yesterday. We're going to continue to talk about the book, The Fourth Turning, by William Strauss and Neil Howe, which makes this bold prophecy. Just after the millennium, America will enter a new era that will culminate with a crisis comparable to the American Revolution, the Civil War, the Great Depression, and World War II. The survival of the nation will most certainly be at stake. Strauss and Howe based this vision on a provocative theory of American history as a series of recurring 80 to 100-year cycles. Each cycle has four turnings, a high, an awakening, an unraveling, and a crisis. The authors locate today's America as midway through an unraveling, roughly a decade away from the next crisis, or what they call the fourth turning. And they recommend ways Americans can prepare for what's ahead as a nation and as individuals.
You have a back of the wind, I'm here for Hiroshima, Detroit, and others.
Everything there is a season. Winter is coming. America feels like it's unraveling. Ladies and gentlemen, though we live in an era of relative peace and comfort, we have settled into a mood of pessimism about the long-term future, fearful that our superpower nation is somehow rotting from within. And of course, it is. Neither an epic victory over communism nor an extended upswing of the business cycle can buoy our public spirit. The Cold War and New Deal struggles are plainly over, but we are of no mind to bask in their seeming successes. You see, the America of today feels worse in its fundamentals than the one many of us remember from youth. A society presided over by those of supposedly lesser consciousness. Wherever we look, from Los Angeles to Washington, D.C., from Oklahoma City to Sun City, we see paths to a foreboding future. We yearn for civic character, but satisfy ourselves with symbolic gestures and celebrity circuses. We perceive no greatness in our leaders, a new meanness in ourselves. Small wonder that each new election brings a new jolt, its aftermath, a new disappointment. Not long ago, America was more than the sum of its parts. Now it is less. Around World War II, we were proud as a people, but modest as individuals. In fact, fewer than 2 people in 10 said yes when asked, "Are you a very important person?" But today, more than 6 in 10 say yes. Where we once thought ourselves collectively strong, we now regard ourselves as individually entitled. And yet, even while we exalt our own personal growth, we realize that millions of self-actualized persons don't add up to an actualized society. In fact, quite the contrary. Popular trust in virtually every American institution, from businesses and governments to churches and newspapers, keeps falling to new lows. Public debts soar, the middle class shrinks, welfare dependencies deepen, and cultural wars worsen by the year. We now have the highest incarceration rate and the lowest eligible voter participation rate of any major nation in this world. Statistics inform us that many adverse trends, such as crime, divorce, abortion, scholastic aptitudes, may have bottomed out, but we're not reassured. It does not make us feel better. In fact, we doubt that it's the truth. Optimism still attaches to self, but no longer to family or community. Most Americans express more hope for their own prospects than for their children's or the nation's. Parents widely fear that the American dream, which was there solidly for their parents, and still there, but just barely for them, will absolutely not be there for their children. And young householders are reaching their mid-30s, never having known a time when America seemed to be on the right track. Middle-aged people look at their thin savings accounts and slim-to-none pensions, scoff at an illusory Social Security trust fund, which in fact does not exist, and try not to dwell on what a burden their old age could become. Seniors separate into their own leisure world, recoiling at the lost virtue of youth while trying not to think about the future. We perceive our civic challenge as some vast, insoluble Rubik's Cube. Behind each problem lies another problem that must be solved first, and behind that lies yet another, and another, ad infinitum. And to fix crime, we have to fix the family. But before we do that, we have to fix welfare. And that means fixing our budget. And that means fixing our civic spirit, but we can't do that without fixing moral standards. And that means fixing schools and churches. And that means fixing the inner cities. And that's impossible unless we fix crime. You see, there's no fulcrum on which to rest a policy lever. People of all ages sensing that something huge will have to sweep across America before the gloom can be lifted, but that's an awareness we suppress as a nation. Ladies and gentlemen, most of us are in a very, very deep denial. While we grope for answers, we wonder if analysis may be crowding out our intuition, like the anxious patient who takes 17 kinds of medicine while poring over his own CAT scan. We find it hard to stop and ask, just what is the underlying malady really about? How can we best bring the primal forces of nature to our assistance? Isn't there a choice lying somewhere between total control and total despair? Because that seems to be the choice, and that seems to be the future. Deep down beneath the tangle of trend lines, we suspect that our history or biology or very humanity must have something simple and important to say to us. But we don't know what it is. If we once did know, we have since forgotten. And, ladies and gentlemen, wherever we're headed, America is evolving in ways most of us do not like or even understand. We are deeply disturbed, individually focused yet collectively adrift. We wonder if we're heading toward a waterfall. What do you think? Are we? Are we headed for a fall? Well, according to William Strauss and Neil Howe, the reward of the historian is to locate patterns that recur over time and to discover the natural rhythms of social experience. And they feel that they've done this in the book, The Fourth Turning. In fact, according to them, at the core of modern history lies this remarkable pattern. Over the past five centuries, Anglo-American society has entered a new era, which they call a new turning, every two decades or so. And at the start of each turning, people change how they feel about themselves, the culture, the nation, and the future. Turnings come in cycles of four. Each cycle spans the length of a long human life, roughly 80 to 100 years, a unit of time the ancients called the cyclum. Together, the four turnings of the cyclum comprise history's seasonal rhythm of growth, maturation, entropy, and destruction. According to Strauss and Howe, the first turning is a high, an upbeat era of strengthening institutions and weakening individualism when a new civic order implants and the old values regime decays. The second turning is an awakening, a passionate era of spiritual upheaval when the civic order comes under attack from a new values regime. The third turning is an unraveling, a downcast era of strengthening individualism and weakening institutions when the old civic order decays and the new values regime implants. And last but not least, and the one that we are now facing according to these two researchers, is called the fourth turning. It is a crisis, a decisive era of secular upheaval, when the values regime propels the replacement of the old civic order with a new one. Each turning comes with its own identifiable mood, and always these mood shifts catch people by surprise. Now, I've got to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, I recommend that you listen carefully to this, and I recommend that you purchase the book, The Fourth Turning. I get nothing from it. I'm not involved in this book in any way, shape, or form, and I have not been paid to commercialize this book on radio or anywhere else. You know me, and you know what I'm up to. And I wouldn't recommend that you do this if I did not think that it was important. For I recognize a lot of things here. I recognized the first turning as the 1950s, post-World War II, for me. The second turning, the 60s, the Kennedy assassination, the hippie or the flower generation. And I recognize myself in the third turning now. I recognize myself as a big part of this third turning. And I know that during the fourth turning, if what they say is correct, during this coming crisis of secular upheaval, I will be a part of the values regime that propels the replacement of the old civic order with a new one. A new one. Something that cannot be corrupted. I've told you a million times, ladies and gentlemen, it's wonderful for all of us to sit around and talk and jaw and converse and speculate on a restoration to the way it used to be. And I have told you over and over and over and over again that it can never be the way that it used to be, but something is going to change for the better or for the worse. We're either going to go back in our evolution of the human race to the enslavement of the common man, which has been the case for most of human history, or we're going to figure a way out of this depth of degradation and corruption and evil and terror. And to make a better world. I don't know quite how that's going to happen, but I know that it has to involve the truth, and that's what I've been about for many years. We must seek the truth, understand the truth, and live in the truth. That's the only way that anything can ever change or be better from what it ever has been, for the history of the world is rife with illusion, lies, deceit, manipulation, enslavement, if you will. Until this great nation was founded, the common man had never been free throughout the history of the world. I don't care what book you read or who told you what. It has never happened. We had the greatest opportunity, the greatest chance of all of the people who have ever been born in history to make the future bright and great and wonderful. And ladies and gentlemen, our fathers and mothers blew it, and we blew it, and our children are getting ready to blow it. If these men are right, there's going to be a terrific, terrible upheaval, a crisis the likes of which the world has never seen. And it will begin in this country. And the outcome will either be the return to the misery that has always been the world, or a bright new future for the whole human race. I vote for the bright new future. But we can't have that future unless we understand our past and where we are at the present and what is about to happen. Strauss and Howe believe that in the current cyclum, the first turning was the American high of the Truman, Eisenhower, and Kennedy presidencies, and I recognize that as such. I was born in 1943, and I recognize that as the best time in my entire life for me, for my family, for this country. They say that as World War II wound down, no one predicted that America would soon become so confident and institutionally muscular, yet so conformist and spiritually complacent. And that's the truth. I could not foresee that. I know my parents could not foresee that. No one ever dreamed that the United States government would grow to become the tremendous, blood-sucking monster that it is now, but that's what happened. That is exactly what has happened. You see, when you read this book, it's going to be a personal awakening. You're going to recognize your life in this book, no matter how old you are or what generation you belong to, because this book is talking about generations. And you're going to find that you fit into one of them just like a fine glove will fit on your hand. They say that the second turning was the consciousness revolution, stretching from the campus revolts of the mid-1960s to the tax revolts of the early 80s. Before John Kennedy was assassinated, no one predicted that America was about to enter an era of personal liberation and cross a cultural divide that would separate anything thought or said after from anything and everything ever thought or said before. But that's exactly what has happened, ladies and gentlemen. According to Strauss and Howe, the third turning has been the culture wars, an era that began with Reagan's mid-80s mourning in America and is due to expire around the middle of the 00 decade, 8 or 10 years from now. Amidst the glitz of the early Reagan years, no one predicted that the nation was entering an era of national drift and institutional decay. Nobody. I couldn't foresee it. I just knew something was wrong. But that's exactly where we are, ladies and gentlemen. Have major national mood shifts like this ever happened before? Well, the answer is yes, many, many times. Have Americans ever before experienced anything like the current attitude of unraveling? Yes, they have, many times over the centuries. Elders in their 80s, and if you have any of those around, sit down and talk to them. Discuss this with them. You will be amazed, ladies and gentlemen. Elders in their 80s can remember an earlier mood that was much like today's. They can recall the years between Armistice Day, 1918, and the Great Crash of 1929, filled with euphoria over a global military triumph that was painfully short-lived. Earlier optimism about a progressive future gave way at that time to a jazz age nihilism and a pervasive cynicism about high ideals. Bosses swaggered in immigrant ghettos. The KKK in the South hung Negroes from trees. The mafia in the industrial heartland and defenders of Americanism in a myriad middle towns. Unions atrophied, governments weakened, third parties were the rage, just like today, and a dynamic marketplace ushered in new consumer technologies, automobiles, radios, phones, jukeboxes, vending machines, that made life feel newly complicated and frenetic. Many people had indoor plumbing in bathrooms and toilets that flushed for the first time in their lives. The risky pleasures of a lost young generation shocked middle-aged decency crusaders, many of them tired radicals, within moralizing against the detritus of the mob decades of their youth, which was the 1890s. Opinions, ladies and gentlemen, polarized around no-compromise cultural issues like drugs. Oh yes, even then, drugs. Family. Yes, back then. And decency, the moral issue. Just like today. Meanwhile, parents strove to protect a scout-like new generation of children who in time aged into today's very senior citizens. Back then, the details were different, but the underlying mood resembled exactly what Americans feel today. This is what Walter Lippmann said, writing during World War I, and I quote, "We are unsettled to the very roots of our being. There isn't a human relation, whether of parent or child, husband and wife, worker and employer, that doesn't move in a strange situation. We are not used to a complicated civilization. We don't know how to behave when personal contact and eternal authority have disappeared. There are no precedents to guide us, no wisdom that was not meant for Americans still alive when today's seniors were little children. And there are some people, ladies and gentlemen, who are 100, 105, 110 years old. Not many, but they are here." In the late 1840s and early 1850s, America drifted into a foul new mood. The hugely popular Mexican War had just ended in a stirring triumph, but the huzzas over territorial gain didn't last long. Cities grew mean and politics hateful. Immigration surged. Financial speculation boomed, and railroads and cotton exports released powerful new market forces that destabilized communities. And having run out of answers, the two major parties, the Whigs and Democrats, were slowly but surely disintegrating. A righteous debate over slavery's westward expansion erupted between so-called Southerners and abolitionists. Many of the middle-aged spiritualists, who in the more euphoric 1830s and 40s had dabbled in transcendentalism. Oh yes, you see, the New Age is not new, ladies and gentlemen. It has appeared and disappeared many, many times throughout the history of the world. Dabbled in transcendentalism. Utopian communes, just exactly like the hippies of the 60s. And other assorted youth-fired crusades. You see, there's nothing new under the sun, just cycles of repetition. Colleges went begging for students as a brazen young generation hustled west to pan for gold in towns fabled for their violence. Meanwhile, a child's generation grew up with a new regimentation that startled European visitors who a decade earlier had bemoaned the wildness of American children. Does that sound familiar to you? Well, it sounds very familiar to me. It has repeated itself. It is exactly what is happening today. But just in case you think this is all a fluke, let's go back yet another lifetime. Run your clock back the length of yet another long life to the 1760s. The recent favorable conclusion to the French and Indian War that brought 80 years of conflict to a close and secured the colonial frontier. Yet when England tried to recoup the expense of the war through taxation, the colonies seethed with a directionless discontent. Immigration from the old world, immigration across the Appalachians, and colonial trade arguments all rose sharply. As debtors' prisons bulged, middle-aged people complained of what Benjamin Franklin called the white savagery of youth. Middle-aged orators, peers of the fiery young preachers of the circa 1740 Great Awakening, awakened civic consciousness and organized popular crusades of economic austerity. The youth, elite, became the very first to attend disciplined church schools in the colonies rather than academies in corrupt Albion. Gradually, colonists began separating into mutually loathing camps, one defending and the other attacking the crown. Does that sound familiar again? Isn't that what is happening today? There are people out there defending the lies, the deceit, the manipulation, the crap that comes out of Washington, D.C., and there are people like me who are attacking that same situation on a daily basis. And during each of these periods, ladies and gentlemen, Americans celebrated an ethos of frenetic and laissez-faire individualism, which was a word first popularized in the 1840s, and yet also fretted over social fragmentation, epidemic violence, and economic and technological change that seemed to be accelerating beyond society's ability to absorb it. And during each of these periods, Americans had recently achieved a stunning victory over a long-standing foreign threat, Imperial Germany, Imperial New Spain, alias Mexico, or Imperial New France. Yet that victory came to be associated with a worn-out definition of collective purpose and perversely unleashed a torrent of pessimism. During each of these periods, an aggressive moralism darkened the debate about the country's future. Culture wars raged. The language of political discourse coarsened. Nativist and sectional feelings hardened. Immigration and substance abuse came under attack, and attitudes toward children grew more protective. And during each of these periods, Americans felt well-rooted in their personal values, but newly hostile toward the corruption of civic life. Unifying institutions, which had seemed secure for decades, suddenly felt ephemeral. Those who had once trusted the nation with their lives were now growing old and passing on. To the new crop of young adults, the nation hardly mattered. The whole res publica seemed on the verge of disintegrating. During each of these previous third turnings, Americans felt like they were drifting toward a cataclysm. And, as it turned out, they were. What were these cataclysms? Well, ladies and gentlemen, don't go away. We're going to find out.
Baby, I've been waiting every day. I didn't see the time. I waited half my life away. There were lots of invitations. I know you sent me some, but I was waiting for the miracle, for the miracle to come. I know you really love me, but you see my hands were tied. And I know it must have hurt you, it must have hurt your pride. I have to stand beneath my window with your bugle and your drum. Early I'm up there waiting for the miracle, for the miracle to come. I didn't believe you would like it. You wouldn't like it here. There ain't no entertainment, and the judgments are severe.
Affiliate stations and loyal listeners to the Hour of the Time, write this down and adjust your schedules accordingly. The Worldwide Freedom Radio Network will continue broadcasting after the afternoon edition of the Hour of the Time with uninterrupted. For the most part, all oldies music interspersed with select and special programming of an informative and educational nature. Followed at 8 p.m. Pacific, 11 p.m. Eastern, by a rerun of that afternoon's Hour of the Time. For those who were working during the day.
Nothing left to do in your bed when you're full of chrome. Nothing left to do when you get to the wrong way.
If you would like to help yourself and help the Worldwide Freedom Radio Network continue to expand its programming, call 1-800-295-2432 right now. Ask about how you can obtain the Economic Survival Pack number 1. Do it now, folks. You know how you are. You know how we all tend to procrastinate.
Most of you was naked. Some of you was lame.
That's 1-800-295-2432. Without your participation in the products that we offer on the Worldwide Freedom Radio Network, we will not succeed, ladies and gentlemen.
Baby, let's get married. We've been alone too long.
The 1760s, ladies and gentlemen, were followed by the American Revolution. The 1850s by Civil War. The 1920s by the Great Depression and World War II. All these unraveling eras were followed by bone-jarring crises so monumental that by their end, American society emerged in a wholly new form. Each and every time, the change came with scant warning. As late as December 1773, November 1859, October 1929, and the 1930s, the American people had no idea how really close it was. Then sudden sparks, the Boston Tea Party, John Brown's raid and execution, Black Tuesday, transformed the public mood swiftly and permanently. Over the next two decades or so, society convulsed. Emergencies required massive sacrifices from a citizenry that responded by putting community ahead of self. Leaders led, and people trusted them. As a new social contract was created, people overcame challenges once thought insurmountable and used the crises to elevate themselves and their nation to a higher plane of civilization. In the 1790s, they triumphantly created the modern world's first constitutional republic. In the late 1860s, wounded but reunited, they forged a genuine nation extending new guarantees of liberty and equality for all. In the late 1940s, they constructed the most Promethean superpower ever seen or ever even anticipated or thought of beyond those wildest projections upon the face of this earth. The fourth turning is history's great discontinuity. It ends one epoch and begins another. You see, history is seasonal, just like the Bible says, and winter, ladies and gentlemen, is coming. And just like nature's winter, the secular winter can come early or late. A fourth turning can be long and difficult, brief but severe, or perhaps even mild. But like winter, it cannot be averted. It must come in its turn, and when it comes, a coldness, a bitterness, and a cruelty comes with it. And winter, winter, ladies and gentlemen, is coming. The Fourth Turning by William Strauss and Neil Howe is a book that literally turns history into prophecy. It is a personal read. It is not like anything that you have ever read before. You will see yourself in the pages involved in a part of this. It is generational, and your generational will have been or will be involved in one of these four turnings, and you will recognize it just as you recognize your own face when you look in the mirror in the morning. It takes you on a journey through the confluence of social time and human life. In part one, seasons, you will acquire new tools for understanding yourself, your family, your society, and civilization as a whole. You will learn about the cycles of life, generational archetypes, turnings, and history, according to William Strauss and Neil Howe. And I say according to William Strauss and Neil Howe because you can find some holes in this, such as, why did they skip World War I? And what happened with Vietnam? Was that a part of the awakening? I was in Vietnam and I didn't feel awakened. And the only way that I can answer that is there are some exceptions to this. There are generations which are fractured, such as my generation. Part of it became the hippie movement, and part of it became the soldiers who fought in Vietnam. And so they experienced different turnings at the same time, when throughout the history before this century, each generation generally experience the same turning at the same time with each other as a part of the whole of it. And World War I, in the scope of this book, did not really affect America. It was a European thing. We did not send great numbers of troops to World War I like we did to World War II. And this book is about the turnings of America. It is about this country, this nation, its history, and its future. And the combination of those two, ladies and gentlemen, that make up this moment, this present, which is affected by both. In part two, turnings, you will revisit post-World War II American history from the perspective of turnings and archetypes. You will gain a new insight about why the first three turnings of the current millennial cyclum have evolved as they have. You will read why this cyclical journey must culminate in a fourth turning and what is likely to happen when it does. And in part three, preparations, you will explore what you and your nation can do to brace for the coming crises, for a crisis is coming. There is no doubt about it, ladies and gentlemen, and most of you out there already know it. You can feel it in your gut. You know something is terribly wrong, and you know that nothing is going to fix it except for something that is world-shattering, that will shake the foundation of this society right down to its very root. Given the current unraveling era mood of personal indulgence and public despair, now may seem like a hopeless time to redirect the course of history, but you will learn how by applying the principles of seasonality. We can steer our destiny, and that's what I've always been about, and that's what the Hour of the Time has always been about, that if we can educate ourselves to the truth of our history and the truth of our present and the truth of the situation that we were in and how we got here and what it all means, then we can make the ultimate outcome a better world for us, our children, and our posterity. There is much that we can accomplish in a cyclical autumn, and that's where we find ourselves. Many steps we can take to help ensure that the coming spring will herald glorious times ahead following the bitter winter. I have drummed into you over and over and over again, ladies and gentlemen, that those who will not study history are doomed to repeat it. But this book drives that nail home. What I want you to do is read the book to make sure that that nail is not being driven home in your coffin. An appreciation for history, ladies and gentlemen, is never more important than at times when a secular winter is forecast. In the fourth turning, we can expect to encounter personal and public choices akin to the harshest ever faced by ancestral generations, exactly as I have been telling you for years. And everybody will have to make a choice. No one will escape that chore. There will be no fence sitters in this coming conflict. We would do well to learn from the experience of past generations viewed through the prism of cyclical time, rather than repeat all of the mistakes again and again and again, as the human race has generally done. This will not come easily. It will require us to lend a new seasonal interpretation to our revered American dream, and it will require us to admit that our faith in linear progress has often amounted to a Faustian bargain with our children. And if you don't understand that, it literally means that you sell your children to the devil so that you can have it easy and you don't have to make the bitter choices. You take the cream. You take the cream and leave the garbage to the children. I know all about that. You see, when I confronted my father with what's happening in the world and the choices that we would have to make, he told me that he's always known about this, but there's nothing that he can do because he gets a government pension and he's afraid that he'll lose it. And besides, he told me, by the time all this happens, your mother and I will be dead. And that's what is meant by a Faustian bargain with our children. That's the bargain that my father made with me. I refuse to make that bargain with my children. Faust always ups the ante, and every bet is double or nothing. And I'm not going to pass that down to my children. Through much of the third turning, we have managed to postpone the reckoning. But history warns us that we cannot defer it beyond the next bend in time. There will be a reckoning. As Arthur Wing Pinero has written, quote, "The future is only the past again, entered through another gate," end quote. And increasingly, ladies and gentlemen, increasingly, Americans are sensing that the next great gate in history is approaching. It's time to trust our instincts. Think seasonally, ladies and gentlemen, and prepare as I have been urging you to do for years, for many years. You see, forewarned is forearmed. And those of you who are sitting on your butts on your couch thinking, well, this can't happen to me. This can't happen here. This is America. You are the ones who will be hurt the most. Many of you will just simply lose your mind when confronted with the reality of how terrible this crisis is going to be. And I feel a great pain for you. But there really isn't anything that I can do about it. You are the only one who can do anything for yourself and your family. And collectively, we can do something for the nation and for the future. You see, you've already reached the point where you have to make the choice. And many of you are thinking that it's down the road a piece. and that you have some respite from that responsibility. And I tell you that you are dreamers, you are fooling yourself, and you are going to pay a terrible and great price for your indecision and for your unwillingness to act, for your denial, if you will. The book is The Fourth Turning. The Fourth Turning by William Strauss, ladies and gentlemen, and Neil Howe. Get it and read it. And we're going to be talking about it some more tomorrow, because this is in-your-face stuff. It's personal. It concerns you and your children, your grandmother and your grandfather, your parents, your grandchildren and your great-grandchildren. And it's about time you were confronted with some reality. Good night, and God bless each and every single one of you.
The birds, they sing at the break of day. Start again, I heard them say. Don't dwell on what has passed away, or what is yet to be. At a war, they will be fought again. The hole they dug, she will be cut again. Body, soul, and body can. The dove is never free. Ring the bell, the sound ring. Forgive your perfect offering. There is a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in. The sand, the sand for sand. The birth of a train, the marriage stand. Yeah, the widowhood of every man. Signs for our sea. Can't run no more with that goddess crown. While the killers in high places say their prayers aloud. But they've summoned, they've summoned a babe from the cloud. Never to hear from me. Let's sing. Forgive your perfect offering.
This is the Voice of Freedom. Ladies and gentlemen, we are on our new schedule. The Worldwide Freedom Radio Network will continue broadcasting, culminating with a repeat of today's broadcast of the Hour of the Time at 8 p.m. Pacific, 11 p.m. Eastern Time. Adjust your schedules accordingly, and affiliate stations, adjust your broadcasting schedule accordingly. listening to the Worldwide Freedom Radio Network. Ladies and gentlemen, if you would like to help yourself and help the Worldwide Freedom Radio Network continue to expand its broadcasting schedule, please call 1-800-295-2432. That's Southwest International Trading. 1-800-295-2432. And ask how you can obtain the Economic Survival Pack number 1. And if you're interested in silver or gold in any quantity, in any form, bullion, numismatic, or coin, please leave your name and phone number and your address, and someone from Southwest International Trading will call you, and we will do our very best to fill your need at the very lowest price that you can find anywhere. And remember, every time that you make a purchase from Southwest International Trading, 50% of whatever profit is obtained from that purchase goes to support the Worldwide Freedom Radio Network.
This is my daddy's station. I'm Pooh, classic radio like you always wished it could be. 101.1 FM, Eager.
Having a hard time finding your favorite show on shortwave or satellite? The Christian Media Newspaper now provides program guides to all the top Christian, patriot, and alternative radio programs.